I'd like to ask you a question. Think for a moment and answer the following question. What do the words God's grace mean to you? To some, grace is what you say before dinner. Right? To others, grace may be defined as the undeserving favor of God. Grace is encompassed by His love for us. And God's grace is extended to us in the sacrificial death of His Son, Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For by grace you are saved, through faith, and not of yourselves." And what's interesting is Paul, in many of his letters, began with the phrase, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." Grace is God giving the greatest treasure to the least deserving. And guess what? That's every one of us in this room. Whether or not we accept God's grace, His favor, His forgiveness, and His love is based upon the spiritual desires of our heart. What's more, God's grace is powerful in that it is the only means that can change the condition of our spiritual heart, especially a hardened heart. And all of us can relate to one of the four that are depicted at various times in our lives. From the hardened heart on the left side to the broken and contrite heart on the right side. As we seek Jesus Christ in our lives and yield to His Lordship, we will learn more about ourselves on the inside. In addition, we will gain an insightful understanding of the reasoning for behaviors of other people. So we learn more about ourselves and what we do and why we do it, as well as other people, what they do and why they do it. In Luke 6:45, a good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, brings forth good. But an evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, brings forth evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. And many times, when we're quiet on the inside and we actually listen to someone else, especially a person that's tormented and so forth, you can hear the negativity. You can hear the difficulties within the heart. You can even see it in their face and even their posture and positioning. It's difficult to not show that. So, we're going to describe the functions, characteristics, and consequences of two opposing conditions of our spiritual heart that are described in the Bible. One is the hardened heart, and on the other end of the spectrum is a broken and contrite heart. The intent here this morning is to illuminate the importance of being aware, that we're individually aware of the spiritual condition of our heart. Number two, to recognize why we do what we do, as well as others, and to witness the transformational influence of God's grace upon a hardened heart. It says in Proverbs, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life. Beginning with the hardened heart, happy is the man who is always reverent, but he who hardens his heart will fall into calamity. Romans 2:5, but in accordance with the hardness and your unrepentant heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. There are three primary ways that a heart can become hardened. One is sin. That sin that we perform, but it's also sin by someone else against us. Abuse is an example. Two, a works-based religion will also harden the heart. That's the type of religion that believes that they're saved by adherence to behavioral laws and not God's unmerited grace in Jesus Christ. A couple of examples, Pharisees in Matthew 23 who believed salvation was based on adherence to religious laws and works. Another example, in its darkest form, ISIS. And the third way is unforgiveness. Primarily unforgiveness of those that have wronged us, as well as forgiving ourselves once our sin has been covered by the blood of the Lamb. How am I doing so far? Good? As the heart hardens, defensive shields will form that are designed to circumvent, repel, evade, thwart, stop what our eyes see and what our ears hear. The consequences are a continually constricted spiritual awareness and an obstruction of the reception of God's grace. In addition to that, an ever-increasing darkness within. Ephesians 4:18 says, they are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. The hardened condition of the heart will even continue and become stronger when we encounter the will of God by the Holy Spirit. And we decide to fight His will by holding on to our pride, by holding on to our arrogance, and as we foolishly justify our decision based upon a self-centered, deceptional lie. The only means to maintain our position and disagreement with God is to increase the hardness of our heart. There's no other option for the stubborn and unwilling heart of one who decides not to listen and obey the Holy Spirit. As an example, consider how the heart of Pharaoh was hardened even when he witnessed miraculous signs from God. He dug his heels in. He would not listen, he would not obey, and he would not yield. The consequences of our folly are a disconnection from the one who loves us, a desensitization of our conscience, internal turmoil, worsening behaviors intended to protect and maintain the heart's hardened condition, and increase darkness. This is what occurs when we decide to turn away from the truth. who continues to scream at us from the inside with a very quiet, patient, and loving voice, calling us to repentance. But praise God that his voice cannot be muted, because God fulfills all of his promises. Even when we attempt to run, he said he would never leave us nor forsake us. Meanwhile, we do everything possible to listen and blindly seek. Everything possible to not listen and blindly seek means to overcome the darkness within our soul. Sometimes we self-medicate, blame others, seek to satisfy the lusts of our flesh, consume useless, mind-numbing information, and even listen to demonically inspired lies that align with and justify our deceived minds. Every one of us can relate to this. We've all been there. But praise God for his grace. But we know deep within our soul we're wrong, dead wrong. What's interesting is that the hardening of the heart will become even stronger for one who knows Jesus Christ than one who does not know Jesus Christ. This type of hardening can occur when one who has been enlightened by the Holy Spirit decides to reject his lordship and return to their old self. When this occurs, to continually reinforce a deceptional lie, one must actively repel all truth, which requires layer upon additional layer of armor. Meanwhile, for this scenario, for this backslidden Christian, there are two options. They can continue along their destructive path by hiding behind a fake front, or they can leave the church. Meanwhile, this person will live in between the saved and the non-saved. Their hardened heart causes them to be unable to relate to those in the world because they know, understand, and see the consequences of sin. And because they're not able to relate to brothers and sisters in Christ because of their condemnation and guilt. Unfortunately, all of us can relate to living life in between, because we've all been there. When you stand back and look at the forest, this struggle really defines the decisive battle of who is Lord of our life, Lord of our heart, Lord of our soul. In the midst of trying to maintain control, in the midst of being pulled in multiple directions, in the midst of all the noise, confusion, pain, and darkness, is a desire deep within our heart to be right with God, to be more like Him, less like ourselves, and to be free from that which binds our soul. Jesus Christ used parables to challenge our thinking, to enlighten our understanding, and to reveal spiritual truths that can only come from the one who designed us. The parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector reveals God is more interested in the attitude, desire, and condition of our heart than our outward behavior. Jesus spoke to those that were righteous and despised others. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with themselves, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes to all that I possess. And the tax collector, standing afar off, wouldn't even raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. The Pharisee believed that salvation was based upon an adherence to religious laws and works and did everything he thought was required. As such, he thought he was good enough. However, he exhibited an additional darkened dimension of a hardened heart. And that's called judgmental hypocrisy. This is when we judge others while failing to recognize our own flaws. But what's truly sad, because of his hardened heart, he was unable to understand the heart of God. Those who place their faith in God's grace, extended to us in the sacrificial death of his son, Jesus Christ, like the tax collector, will see themselves and God from a completely different perspective. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespass and sin, he made us alive together with Christ. Softening and healing of a hardened heart begins when we reach the point where we've had enough, especially of ourselves, when the pain exceeds the pleasure. This is when a crack will occur in the armor that's protecting our heart. This is when a sliver of light by the Holy Spirit can enter and illuminate his truth. This is when our hardened heart begins to weaken from the internal pressure of regret and sorrow. This is when God's grace begins to act as a solvent to dissolve the hardened layers and even soften the scars. And this is when we witness our hearts broken and contrite transformation. And if you look at the graphic of the heart on the right side, there's scars there. Will they go away forever? No. Will it be softened? Yes. Is it possible God can use those scars to help minister to other people? Absolutely. Next slide. Broken is defined as damaged, altered, or disrupted by change. Contrite is a feeling of sorrow and remorse for sin. However, a broken and contrite heart is more. It's much more. A broken and contrite heart occurs when we see and understand the depth of our depravity, our sinful nature. It's when we despise who we are. It's when we're repulsed by what we've done. It's when we accept responsibility for what we've done. It's also when we realize the uselessness of trying to rely upon our flawed, self-centered decisions and learn to decide and to trust God. It's when we desire to become more like Jesus and less like ourselves. And this is when our pride will melt into humility. This is when we humbly will kneel before the mercy of God and the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And this is when God can change us from within. In addition, a broken and contrite heart will grieve over their sin. They will not judge other people, but rather they will be filled with understanding and compassion. What's more, they will not allow sinful thoughts to fester into unrighteousness. They will seek the strength of God to move towards His holiness. They will be renewed by trials and tribulation, and they will experience the deepest form of love known, agape, which only comes from God. But on this one I will look on him who is poor and of a contrite spirit, and who trembles at my word. For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take your heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a new heart of flesh. For thus saith the high and lofty one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and holy place with him who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. I pray this message this morning provides you with a greater understanding of the conditions of your heart. But more important, you yield moment by moment to His Lordship as He prepares us to live with Him for eternity. Because blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Now in the next moment or two, we're going to show a wonderful music video. You may find an emotional impact that reaches the very core of your heart and soul. Worship Him and praise Him. Let it go.
can I say? I know there's no way to repay you, only to offer you my praise. Your grace still amazes me, your love is still a mystery. Each day I fall on my knees, 'cause your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me. It's deeper, it's wider, it's stronger, it's higher, it's deeper,
it's deeper,
it's wider.
Each day.